Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Today, to an unprecedented degree, technological advances are bringing the nature of our solar system's sun into clearer focus. With ever finer data, the ability to test competing theoretical models, and hopefully to resolve mysteries becomes greater and greater. One such mystery is the unexpectedly hot temperature of the solar wind as it extends away from the sun. Recently, a team of scientists from the University of Wisconsin-Madison performed a study to try to find an answer to the puzzle, and their search led them to the field of plasma physics. A phys.org report describes the standard interpretation of the hot solar wind conundrum. With more negatively charged electrons streaming away, the sun takes on a positive charge. This makes it harder for the electrons to escape the sun's pull. Some electrons have a lot of energy and keep traveling for infinite distances. Those with less energy can't escape the sun's positive charge and are attracted back to the sun. As they do, some of those electrons can be knocked off their tracks ever so slightly by collisions with surrounding plasma. The lead author of the aforementioned study states, "There is a fundamental dynamical phenomenon that says that particles whose velocity is not well aligned with the magnetic field lines are not able to move into a region of a strong magnetic field. Such returning electrons are reflected so that they stream away from the sun, but again they cannot escape because of the attractive electric force of the sun. So their destiny is to bounce back and forth, creating a large population of so-called trapped electrons." At first glance, such language might seem resonant with the electric sun model, first proposed by engineer Ralph Juergens, and later developed and in some respects modified by Dr. Donald Scott and physicist Wal Thornhill. However, the University of Wisconsin-Madison scientists proposed that a theoretical magnetic process is the mechanism behind the mysterious solar wind heating. We asked retired professor of electrical engineering, Dr. Donald Scott, for an electric sun explanation of the aforementioned phenomenon.
As time goes on, we here in the electric universe are hearing more and more often about these, quote, new astronomical discoveries that are not really new at all. What is new is the recent increase in the inclusion of electrical ideas in these astronomical press releases. And a good example is what you just quoted from the University of Wisconsin's press release. But although more references are presently being made by astronomers of electrical topics like electrons and positive ions and their flows and movements and separation, astronomers never used to admit that electrons and positive ions could be separated in charge separation in space, so it can't be. But I still would remind everybody that the words current, electric current, and electric fields are almost always completely absent. And a case in point is our electric sun model, which has been around a long, long time now. We do have, in the model, it's inherently, there is charge separation. And I thought, was when I read what you just read, I whimsically went back in my mind and said, well, how did all this electric sun thing get started? These guys never heard of it, obviously. Actually, it got started back in 1908. When Christian Birkeland hypothesized that our auroras were caused by streams of electrically charged particles coming from the sun. And everybody, at least in the EU, I think, knows it ad nauseum by now. He was adamantly opposed and ridiculed by astronomers for these ideas. I mean, this went on for decades, even after the poor man had died. But Birkeland was not forgotten, at least not by us. But this press release says that the solar wind was, quote, discovered in 1959. Now, that got my attention. I wouldn't mind if they'd said its existence was verified in 59 when we set some rockets up and saw that, yes, there indeed were charges floating around up there and coming into the North Pole of the Earth. But they act as though Birkeland had never proposed it. They almost act as though Birkeland had never existed and nobody ever knew about it. And I kind of resent that. Our present electric sun model is a direct result of Birkeland's original insight that the auroras are caused by cosmic flows of electricity. But this model is the result of the work of many researchers, from Christian Birkeland to Hannes Alfvén, and I humbly add my own name at the end of that as well. The prime organizer of these ideas about the sun was the late civil engineer Ralph Juergens. And he had carefully studied the earlier plasma research of a Scottish mathematician and physicist whose name is C.E.R. Bruce. Bruce had made the first major change in the theory of how lightning paths function since their description by Benjamin Franklin way back in the dim distant past. And this work and Bruce's attendance at Sidney Chapman's 1941 Kelvin lecture on the sun led Bruce to apply these ideas to cosmic phenomena and to a new electric vision of the universe. And that has eventually developed into the electric sun model. In 1970, I read a paper by Juergens about the electrical properties of the sun's photosphere. And it was published, would you believe, in a chemical engineering journal by Juergens, who's a civil engineer, about an electrical phenomenon. Everything Juergens said there in that paper was completely consistent with what I had been taught earlier as a student and taught myself as a professor about electrical engineering having to do with plasmas. A good portion of electrical engineers, at least in those days, were into plasma research. Anyway, reading that paper, I was hooked. I worked for several years at studying and adding, trying my best to add to Juergens' basic ideas. And the point being that the electric sun model is the product of the dedicated work of a long, long string of many people for many years. And these people, like the ones who wrote this memo, never heard of it, I guess. Anyway, it turns out our present electric sun model inherently explains many, if not all, of these solar phenomena that astronomers cannot explain. And they continue to absolutely ignore its existence. We often hear the phrase, quote, "that process is not completely understood," unquote. Actually, what they mean is, what they should have said, quote, is, "we have no idea why this is going on, but send us more money and when we'll invent another invisible mechanism or force to explain it." A prime example of these processes that they don't know too much about is the solar wind, which they do mention in this press release. But Birkeland suggested its existence, and the electric sun model gives us a clear explanation of the structure and exactly where it comes from and why it behaves as it does. And for example, the article does not mention the fact that the solar wind comes in, and it's well known, two different varieties. There's the fast solar wind and the slow solar wind, and they're two different manifestations, two different varieties of the same animal, the solar wind itself. The fast solar wind is a flow of ions and electrons that has high velocity, but it's not very dense. There's very few ions in it. And it comes out of the tops of the photospheric tufts, which make up the surface of the photosphere, which are highly charged regions that hold back the flood of ions that would otherwise result. In other words, you've got this bunch of things that are positively charged. They repel other positive charges, and if positive charges within the sun are trying to escape, these tufts line up almost like a bunch of soldiers and prevent the escape of these other inside ions. Ions that do get over the top of the tufts, though, then fall through the energy drop of the voltage of the tufts, pretty much like a water that falls over the top of an overfilled dam. There are not too many of them that manage to do it, to get over there, but the ones that do fall the whole distance all the way down to face the dam. And this is what gives them their high velocity. But relatively few of them can make the trip, and so that's why the fast solar wind is very low density. Now, on the other hand, the slow solar wind has only about half the velocity of the fast wind, but it's quite dense. There's many more particles per unit volume, and it comes from sunspots and other disturbed regions on the sun's surface where there are no tufts to hold them back. And so it's like somebody poked a hole in the dam, and therefore this flow is very dense. Many ions per unit volume, nothing to really prevent their escape. But since they're not accelerated by falling through a large voltage drop, their maximum velocities are only about half of that of the fast wind particles. Anyway, this explanation of the two varieties of the solar wind is inherent in the electric sun model. It mimics the operation of a PNP transistor. Now, I'm an electrical engineer and I understand that. It's no wonder astronomers shun our electric universe ideas, and they find that the explanation of this mechanism is not well understood because they don't know anything about electrical engineering. Anyway, I hope that everybody knows that the Sapphire Project, which most people I think are beginning to have heard about, was organized, funded, and manned through the kind generosity of the patrons who support the Electric Universe, for one major purpose. The purpose of Sapphire was to test the validity of the electric sun model in every possible way. Montgomery Childs, the director of Sapphire, and its chief investigator, has publicly announced that this has been done and that the electric sun model has passed each and every test they could throw at it. Yet it is ignored by astrophysicists. Also, some peripheral results from Sapphire are interesting to note. For example, many astrophysicists have claimed for years that there cannot be any strong electric fields within cosmic plasma, that they would be shorted out by the near-perfect conductivity of the plasma. Plasma is very highly conductive in certain directions. But one day, the Sapphire team measured an electric field strength in the Sapphire chamber of over 8,000 volts per meter. And they maintained it, it was static, and it lived happily inside the plasma of the Sapphire project. Anyway, this shows that the observed acceleration of the fast solar wind particles, which cannot be explained by any other mechanism, can easily be explained by an electrically charged sun. And I make reference to that first sentence in that quote from the press release. It says, with more negatively charged electrons streaming away, the sun takes on a positive charge. Yes, yes, I got that right. It does take on a positive charge. Not for the reasons they suggest, but that positively charged sun is responsible for the acceleration of the solar wind, which they didn't really mention. The strength of the required electric field to accelerate the fast solar wind has been calculated. I did it, and other people have done it, to not be greater than about 7/10 of a microvolt per meter. 7/10 of a millionth of a volt per meter. And this only requires the solar voltage to be around 2,700 volts. So Juergens, in his first paper, was thinking about 10 to the 10th volts or some monstrous voltage on the sun. From our observations, at least the observations of the solar wind acceleration, it doesn't have to be anything even close to that. So the electric universe ideas, of which the electric sun model is one of the most important, I submit, is getting to be like the elephant in the room. They know about it, they don't want to see it, and they don't want to discuss it. I hope that soon they will have to.